Hey guys, and welcome to this spine animation tutorial. In this video, you will learn how to create a rig for the character, how to use meshes and weights in spine, and many more small tricks that will make your character look alive. But before we start, make sure that you subscribe to the channel and hit the bell to be the first one to know once the new video is out. Okay, so let's get started! Here is our king of vegetables, or as we call him, King Broco. And I'm going to use this exact character in my game Fruits Against Vegetables. Broco is already sliced to a number of images or layers, and each image has already been attached to a different slot. We'll start from creating meshes for each one of the images. Just click on the image and choose Mesh option, and then click Edit Mesh. A new panel will pop up, and here I'm going to choose New Mesh. Great! Now you see that Spine shows only a specific image that you are working on. That really makes the process easier, and don't worry, the rest of the images will be shown again once you finish creating the new mesh. Okay, so to get started, simply choose a spot somewhere close to the image outline and click it. You don't need to hold the mouse key, it's just a single click. Then go ahead and click somewhere close to the previous spot. And try to follow the shape of the image. If you want to zoom in or out, just scroll with your mouse. Try to stay close to the edges, and don't worry if the mesh doesn't look perfect, because you can always make adjustments and modify it later on. Now, here is something important about the meshes. All those dots are called vertices, and you can see the vertices count here, at the bottom of the screen. The more vertices your mesh has, the more calculations your animation will require, and in the end, it might affect your game performance. So, on one hand, if you'll add too many vertices, it might slow down the game, and on the other hand, if you'll add too little, the image will look distorted, and the movement will look unnatural. So, how do you find the balance then? Well, actually, you'll want to make the meshes more detailed and add more vertices just in the areas that are going to bend. In the rest of the areas, you'll want to keep the number of the vertices to the minimum. And again, if you feel like you've added too many vertices, don't worry, you can delete them by using Delete tool. Close the mesh by clicking on the first dot that you've created. Okay, congratulations! Here's our first mesh. However, we're not done with it yet. Let's switch to Create tool and add some more vertices on top of the image itself to allow smooth movement later on. We'll start from the top and here, right in the middle, click and move the mouse down while holding the left key. I'm releasing the left key when I'm between the next two dots, trying to make a straight line between them. Then I'm clicking the last node I've created, holding the left key, and moving down again, just about here, between the dots on the both sides of the mesh. And same once again, clicking the last dot, holding the left key, moving down, and releasing the left key. I'm switching to Modify tool to adjust the position of these new vertices. Now, let's switch back to Create tool and connect the dots on the sides with those in the middle. Clicking the node, holding the left key, moving to the center, releasing the key. Same actions, over and over again, until all the nodes are connected to the yellow line in the middle. I think it's about time to explain what I'm actually doing right now. Basically, these yellow lines help us control the mesh deformation more accurately, like preventing these areas from looking distorted, and they also will help us build a 3D feel later on. And I know that it's time-consuming, but trust me, the effort is worth the outcome, because the movement is going to look much more smooth and natural than without these additional vertices. So basically, I'm going to add such lines to most of the parts of the image. The process is the same for the remaining parts as well, so I'm going to speed up the video to save your time. Okay, so now when we've finished with the crown, I'm going to add a little bit more nodes in the important areas of the image that I want to be less affected by the deformation. Like the lower part of the crown, it should be pretty solid, the forehead, the cheeks, and the upper part of the king's garment. Then I'll go ahead and continue the yellow line that starts at the central tip of the crown, and I'll make it go all the way down until the part where the garment splits in two. Then I'll connect the nodes that I've created before to the central line, just like we did previously. I delete the nodes that feel redundant to me and adjust the position to the central nodes to create some nice straight lines in the bending areas. Same about the lower tips of the garment, creating the line in the center and connecting the nodes. Pretty straightforward. Now, I'm going to follow the same procedure to create the meshes and additional vertices for the rest of the images. So again, I'm going to speed up the video and continue my explanation when I'll start to create the bones. Alright, so now when we have our meshes ready, let's switch to Create tool and make the bones for our character's skeleton. Now, don't think of a skeleton as something anatomically correct, because it's not. After all, broccoli shouldn't have any bones at all. But this is how the skeleton animation works, and we're going to create bones for the important parts of our character, and the areas that are going to bend, like even the hair will have some bones. By default, each spine skeleton comes with a root bone. You can see it here below. I usually keep it unchanged as a point of reference for the floor, and I create a different bone instead that will be like the core bone for the rig. To do that, choose the root bone, hold Ctrl on Windows or Command on Mac, choose the image to attach, and just click. Here, somewhere around the hips or waist area should be fine. Great! Now let's create another bone right above this one. Hold Ctrl, choose the image, click above the previous bone, and hold the left mouse key to create this long bone. Somewhere in the middle of the bending area should be good. Let's follow the same procedure to create another bone. Hold Ctrl, choose the image, hold the left key, and release. Okay, basically now each new bone is a child bone of the previous one. What does it mean? It means that if you move the parent bone, all the child bones will move as well. Even if it sounds complicated now, don't worry, it will be clear once we'll start animating our character. Now, if I want to break this hierarchy and create another child bone to the same parent, I simply need to choose it and follow the same procedure as before. You can see those small red arrows, and they show the hierarchy, how the new bone is affected by other bones. Okay, let's do this once again. Choose the bone, hold Ctrl, choose the image, and create a new bone. Same for the lower part of the garment. See, each side of the garment should move independently from one another, but both of them are affected by the upper part. Great! Now let's connect the belly to the core bone. Choose the bone, hold Ctrl, choose the belly image, and create a bone. Same with the legs, the first one, and the second one. Good! Let's proceed to the arms, and I'll create two bones for each one of them to make them bend in the elbow. Alright, now the second one. Great! Now let's move to the hair, and let's connect it to the bone on the forehead and the lower part of the crown. Choose the bone, hold Ctrl, choose the hair, and start creating bones. I will connect all parts of the hair to the forehead bone so that they can move independently. Awesome! We've completed a large part of the rig. We have bones for the body, the arms, the feet, and even the hair. But we still didn't touch the face, and I pay special attention to the face because obviously this is what makes the character show emotions and really start to look alive. We're going to add bones to every single part of the face to make it look awesome, and we'll start from the core bone for the whole face. I'm going to connect it to this bone and the eyes, and I usually place it somewhere around the nose. That will really help us move the whole face up or down, or sideways. Okay, let's proceed to adding some bones to the brows. So hold the Ctrl key, choose the brows, and start adding the bones one after another. I don't recommend adding more than 3 bones per brow, because you simply will not use more than that. Even 3 bones might be an overkill, so keep it simple, guys. Okay, so let's connect the second brow to the central bone of the face to make it move separately from another brow. 1, 2, and 3. Then let's add the bones to the mouth. You can see that I create a central bone for the mouth as well, so that I can move the right half without moving the left half, and vice versa. Again, that might be an overkill, but I just like to make it detailed. Great! Now the eyes, same principle as before. Creating a central bone somewhere around the pupil, and then creating the bones on top of the lashes. The hierarchy here is important, so pay special attention to it. Moving to the other eye, central bone, and the lashes. Again, you might want to use less bones for the lashes, and that's absolutely okay. Then, let's proceed to the mustache. He should be able to move it as well. Left one, and the right one. And lastly, the beard. Great! Now we've got a nice and quite a detailed rig for our King of the Veggies, but before we start animating, we need to bind the bones to the meshes and calculate the weights. That's actually quite easy because Spine does a pretty good job calculating all this stuff for you automatically, and you just need to tell it what bones would you like to bind to the mesh. Let me show you how it's done. I'm choosing the weights tool here below, and let's start with something simple, like the arm. I'm just clicking on the image, and a new panel pops up. I'm pressing Bind button, then clicking the bones that are on top of the image. Then pressing Bind again. Great! Now, if I choose the Rotate tool and test the arm, see how it's bending nicely around the elbow area. Cool, so let's go ahead and bind the bones for the second arm as well. Choosing the image, clicking Bind, choosing the bones, and clicking Bind again. Checking the result. Looks pretty good! Now, the body is going to be a bit more tricky than that, and we'll need to make some manual adjustments here. First, let's bind the bones as we did before. That's the easy part. Click Bind, and the weights are automatically calculated. So far, so good, but here is a small problem. Here, in the bending area, you can notice a bit of pink color. This color means that the area is affected by the pink bone, which is related to the garment below. If I move that bone, it moves the back of the head as well, and it definitely shouldn't do that. So let's fix it. Going back to the waist tool, then holding the Control key on Windows or Command on Mac, and starting to click on every node affected by the pink bone in this problematic area. Then I'm choosing the pink bone from the list. In my case, it is bone number 15, holding the left mouse key and moving it down. The pink has disappeared from the area, and you see that the back of the head is not affected by the movement of the garment anymore. Let's check the rest of the bones and make sure that they move correctly, and then bind the bones to the hair, just as we did before. The hair moves in a really cool way, and that's because we've added those additional vertices. Okay, now what's left is to bind the face bones to the meshes on the face. Let's start with the mouth, because that's the easiest part. Same as before, picking the bones and clicking bind. Yeah, should be good enough. Now, the brows. And here we should use the same trick with the manual adjustment again, because I want the brows to move independently from one another. Well, of course, you could just make two separate images for the brows, but I like to keep the eyes and the brows in pairs because I have a lot of different eyes and brows for a character. Basically, each emotion has a different set of them, so this is just how I keep them organized. Great! Now, we need to do the same for the eyes. Binding the bones to the mesh, and then adjusting the weights so that moving one eye doesn't affect the other. Let's check how it works. That's actually pretty good. And the last thing left to do is coloring the bones. This is not mandatory, but I highly recommend doing this because it really makes it easier to notice the bones while animating the character. I usually color different parts of the rig in a different color. Like, let's make the arms red, the feet orange, the body and the garment purple, and so on. You just hold Control or Command, select the bones, then click this gray area near color here below and pick the color, like this. Just make sure that these colors are easily seen on your character. That's it for now. We've got our character ready for animation. So, join me in the next video to learn how to make it move like this and create your first idle animation for the character. Thank you for watching, and see you soon!